And once again, I'm here to talk about current boosting in linear regulators. I know I might be starting to get boring, but today I just wanted to quickly show you how to do the same thing with a power NPN with the conventional circuit and call it a day. However, it turned out to be way more interesting and fun than I thought it would be, or at least my kind of fun. And maybe if you're watching these kind of videos in your free time, you're kind of fun as well, so try to bear with me for the last video of this series. Let's say you wanted to build your own current boosted linear regulator with a power NPN and a small power PNP. Yes, we still need at least a PNP. So as everyone does, you search on Google how to build this circuit. And in the middle of the garbage circuits you usually find on Google, you find one that seems to make sense. Let's give a better look. This, let's call it conventional circuit, can be found in different websites and forums. If you already watched the first video of this series, you might already grasp how it works. The voltage drop on the first resistor turns on the PNP, which will provide current to the second resistor, which, again, will turn on the NPN. Really nothing too fancy. And that's it. If you don't want to learn anything new today, you can stop watching now. If you're still here, that means that, like me, you question the whys and hows of everything. And maybe right now you're wondering whether you really need that second resistor. Couldn't the current provided by the PNP turn on directly the NPN? I wondered the same and I couldn't get my head around it, so let's try to understand it through an analytical approach. First of all, this configuration here is also known as Ziklai pair, and it acts as a PNP transistor where the beta is equal to the product of the two single transistors, similar to a Darlington pair. We can start analyzing the conventional circuit. I'll take as granted all this stuff I've said in the first video of this series, so we can go much faster with the math. Let's first use our regulator model, and then our transistor model. This time we'll have two I tilde, I tilde 1, which refers to the turn-on current of the PNP, and I tilde 2, referring to the turn-on current of the NPN. Let's consider directly the scenario in which the load current is high enough to have both transistors on. Regardless, if RB2 is high enough, there will be only a very small load current range in which only the PNP is conducting, and it can be neglected. The base current of the PNP will be equal to the regulator current ID minus I tilde 1. And obviously, the collector current will be the same times beta. The base current of the NPN will be equal to the current coming from the PNP, IC1, minus I tilde 2. Again, for the collector current, we just multiply beta. And using the expression of IC1, we arrive here. From Kirchhoff's current law, we easily can tell that the load current is equal to the sum of both collector current minus the one provided by the regulator. Use the expression found before and after some math, you can find this. And as that minus 1 is small and uncomfortable to work with, we can ignore it and finally arrive to the final result. We could further simplify it, discarding also the plus 1, but we're maybe going a little bit over the edge. Since this time we need to carefully check that our small power PNP doesn't let the magic smoke out, we need to compute its collector current as well, which is simply equal to this. Let's now give a look at our circuit without the mysterious resistor. Well, the math this time is even easier and basically the same for the classic PNP-only schematic. So, without losing too much time, I'll give you directly the results of the regulator current and the PNP collector current. If we compare the two results, they look kinda the same. The conventional circuit only shows the little current overhead given by I tilde 2, both in the regulator current and in the PNP collector current. Considering a real scenario in which beta 1 is 150, beta 2 is 30, since power transistors usually have lower current gains, and we want a load current of 3 amps, we'll consider a voltage drop of 0.6 volts for both transistors. And we want the boosting circuit to trigger at 500 milliamps, while for the conventional schematic, the NPN to trigger with 1 milliamp of the PNP current. And here the result. You can see that the regulator current is basically the same in both cases, while with the resistor, the PNP will need to provide that small current overhead exactly equal to I tilde 2. From the last video, we've learned that the base emitter voltage variation of the transistor is quite important with I collector current. So let's consider a variation delta V of the base emitter voltage of the NPN transistor which is the one carrying most of the current, and see how it affects the PNP collector current. If we look at the circuit with no resistor, you can see that there is no dependency of the PNP collector current with the variation of that voltage. However, the one with the resistor has that I tilde 2 term, which is highly dependent on that voltage drop. So for high load currents, we will have an increment of the collector current of our small power PNP. So we found that not only the additional resistor is useless, but without it, the circuit performs even a little better for our purposes, even though the difference is so small that it really won't matter in practical cases. Then why that useless resistor? Do people have resistor to spare and just add them everywhere? Well, there is actually a motivation behind. Thick light pairs and Darlington as well have a problem. When you try to turn them off, the second transistor base emitter junction is left sort of floating. To turn a junction off, you need to remove the charge built up in the PN junction. Think of it like a capacitor. If you leave it floating, it takes way more time than usual. Adding that resistor instead provides a lower impedance discharge path, allowing to turn off the transistor quickly. Moreover, with no resistor, any leakage current from Q1 goes straight to the base of Q2 and gets amplified by the bit of the transistor. The resistor then limits the leakage current injected into Q2 base. Now, are those things a problem for us? Surely that isn't really a switching circuit in which a higher turn-off time might be problematic. However, it might happen that the leakage current from Q1 could turn on Q2, which is obviously something we don't want to happen. So I'd say, although I don't think this is really a critical circuit and it probably won't matter, just add that resistor, you've got nothing to lose. Long video to get to this conclusion, but I like not to take anything for granted, even a small resistor.